grandfather doesn't judge. He loves. That's what experience does. He's watched so many seasons come and go, seen stories written and heard them retold, witnessed dynasties rise up and fall down. He can't be surprised because he's been around for a long, long time.
This is the Rose Bowl.
But he would be pleased to see his legacy carried on, his traditions followed, his name spoken with respect, even awe. To visit him is a childhood dream. To honor him is a calling. He knows how much this trip means to you. He also knows victory's thrill and the sting of defeat will fade. So he doesn't care if you win or lose. Just try your best and let fate do the rest. And when it's over, with a knowing smile, he'll nod your way as if to say, you will always remember the day you played in the Granddaddy of Them All. You are looking live at one of the grandest venues in American sport, the Rose Bowl in Pasadena, California. It's presented by Northwestern Mutual. Back in 1902, Stanford played in the very first Rose Bowl game. Now they're back for the 15th time as champions again of the Pac-12. Iowa, the Big Ten, comes to Pasadena for the first time in 25 years. And the Hawkeyes brought along thousands of their loyal fans. Nothing, folks, signifies a new year like the Rose Bowl with its pageantry framed by the beautiful San Gabriel Mountains. Happy New Year, everybody. I'm Brett Musburger along with Jesse Palmer. Jesse, I know you were here earlier in the season for a UCLA game, but you know, there's nothing quite like a Rose Bowl game on New Year's Day.
You're right, Brent. Tradition, pageantry, legacy. I think three words have been synonymous with this game forever. And what a matchup we have here today. Two really tough roads these two teams took to get here. I think about Stanford and the job David Shaw did, take them through a grueling 13-game season. They win the Pac-12 championship. They're in their third Rose Bowl in the last 4 years. And what about Kirk Ferentz at Iowa in his 17th year? 12-0 in the regular season. Still people doubt them because of who they didn't play in conference. I think it was that loss against Michigan State that really woke everybody up, showed us that they're a legit team deserving to be here in the Rose Bowl for the first time in 25 years.
And Jesse, we've got a very special player, Christian McCaffrey of Stanford.
And Brent, I think he's the most versatile player in the entire country, the runner-up to the Heisman Trophy, AP Player of the Year, because he can do everything. He can run the football between the tackles with power, speed to beat you outside. He's dangerous in the return game, and he's a phenomenal receiver. And I really think today, that's where he can be an X factor. Iowa's defense likes to play with three linebackers on the field. There's going to be opportunities today to get McCaffrey one-on-one isolated out of the backfield against the linebacker in the pass game. You see he's got so much quickness, change of direction. I think that's a place that Stanford feels they can find a lot of their explosive plays on offense. There's a reason this guy almost had 3,500 total yards. That's an FBS record. Receiving the football, one of those reasons.
Jesse, let's go down below and wish a very happy new year to our colleague Maria Taylor. Maria.
Well, happy New Year's, Brett. And you know, Stanford is no stranger to the Rose Bowl. In fact, they've been to three of the last four Rose Bowl games, and they even had the third most appearances all time. But this year, David Shaw says that his team is appreciating just a little bit more. And senior quarterback Kevin Hogan says it's because they know how easily this game can be taken away. He says of all of his three appearances, this is the most significant because the team had to come together and redefine themselves after the loss to Northwestern in the very first game of the season. Right now, the seniors are focused on one record. They are 1-1 in the Rose Bowl game, and they say they have no intention of leaving with a losing record.
Thank you, Maria. And on the other side, you know, Jesse, if we go back in time with these Hawkeyes to the end of last season, the fan base was very unhappy, and so too were the coaches and players.
They were, but they're a phenomenal team that proved a lot in that Big Ten title game. And I think a big X factor for them today is quarterback C.J. Beathard, maybe one of the more underappreciated players in the entire country. Iowa runs the football. We know that. He's considered a game manager, which in today's era of football, a lot of people take as an insult, but he's a phenomenal complement to their running game. Tremendous decision maker, doesn't turn the ball over. He's competitive, and he can scramble. He can extend plays, and he's going to have to do that today. We know Iowa's going to line up in the I formation. They're going to run the ball downhill. But I think C.J. Beathard has to be able to make plays with his arm and his legs if Iowa's going to win their first Rose Bowl since 1959.
The grand entrance of the Iowa Hawkeyes. And now the run out by the Stanford Cardinal. And our star of stars, Christian McCaffrey. He will touch the ball first if the kicker gives him an opportunity, and we will see what Marshall Kane does with this kickoff for the Hawkeyes. Did not get a chance, so he will come out now after the touchback on the 25-yard line. And here comes Kevin Hogan. This is his last game as quarterback of the Stanford Cardinals.
And Brad, Kevin Hogan is battle tested. He's a 4-year starter. This is his 46th start and his third Rose Bowl game. He's played in a lot of big ones, makes phenomenal decisions with the football. He's going to have an opportunity, I think, here today to put up some impressive numbers because Stanford likes to run the ball as often as they do. I think there's going to be a lot of opportunities for him in the play action game, throwing it deep down the field. He's also very athletic. He can make some plays with his feet, too.
The game plan for Stanford is to use multiple tight ends. In practice, they use them all week long here in preparation. Hogan to the middle, and it's complete. McCaffrey, will he score on the first play from scrimmage? Yes. A lightning bolt.
And we talked about this in our open, Brent. Stanford would try and use Christian McCaffrey out of the backfield versus linebackers and versus safeties one-on-one against that base defense that Iowa likes to play with. Iowa does not substitute a lot of extra DBs on the field, and right there you see why Christian McCaffrey, the most versatile player in the country.
Conrad Ukropina, he adds the extra point. And folks, he's a story today, adding that extra point. He's the only player who grew up in the city of Pasadena.
Going back and taking a look at this touchdown, it's very, very simple. They've got Christian McCaffrey right here. Lomax at safety is the guy that has to cover a man-to-man. This is simply an option route where he breaks inside. There are not very many running backs that can run the entire route tree. Christian McCaffrey's dad, of course, the great Ed McCaffrey, who played at Stanford, went on to have a phenomenal year with the Denver Broncos. Well, he passed those genes on to his son. This is just too easy, pitch and catch.
Let me interrupt you, Larry. Mom is Lisa, who played soccer at Stanford, and her father is David Syme, who was an Olympic silver medalist, and she just said to me, that's where the speed genes come from.
Yeah, that's right, and he's got a brother who plays at Duke as a wide receiver and an uncle that played basketball at Duke. The family genes are phenomenal, and I feel like the best of everybody kind of somehow got stuck with this guy, number 5, right here for Stanford. He's special.
Now it is imperative that the Hawkeyes answer here. They will kick it short. He runs up to the 10. To the 29-yard line. And now we welcome the young man. And just when we talked to the coaches, they said that C.J. Beathard, one of his strengths was a quick arm.
Yeah, he's got a quick arm. He can also run and scramble. And I'll say this, he's not the flashiest quarterback in the country, certainly not the biggest, doesn't have the strongest arm, he's not the fastest, but he just competes. He makes plays, and he's got tremendous toughness. He's played most of the year with a hip and a groin injury. He's got that X factor, that moxie, that's got to come through today.
Jordan Kanziri is starting, and that's good news for Iowa Hawkeye fans. Injured an ankle against Michigan State in the Big Ten Championship. And we have movement up front. The head linesman will come over to Reggie Smith now.
Ball start, offense, number 80, 5-yard penalty. It's first down.
So let's take a look at tonight's Chick-fil-A impact player.
Well, we know that Kanziri has the injury to the ankle, but I was going to use a lot of backs. So LaShawn Daniels, Akram Wadley, a bunch of different guys are going to have to carry the football. Matt Vandenberg is the leading receiver for Iowa, has to make plays outside. Blake Martinez, a tackling machine, needs to play big against this running game. Very, very critical. There's a lot of key players in this contest.
Kanziri with the first carry. And Aziz Chatou makes the first stop of the game. He was a five-star recruit for Stanford. Outstanding defensive line.
Brent, he was our fourth impact player. This is a guy up front for Stanford that does a phenomenal job in the run game. Extremely athletic, and he has the ability to defeat blocks with quickness off the line of scrimmage. Big reason why he was selected first team all Pac-12.
We would expect now Beathard to throw his first pass of the game. Derek Mitchell slips out of the backfield. He has the first reception. He's the third down specialist. This will be third and short. Dallas Lloyd with the snap.
And this is exactly where Iowa wants to be living in this football game. They want to avoid third and long situations and obvious pass situations. Very big, very fortuitous, getting the offside penalty a snap ago. Now you get a short completion to the back. And this is what Iowa will do, line up and count on their physical offensive line to reestablish the line of scrimmage and run the football downhill.
Austin Blythe is the center. He's the ringleader of this offensive line. On third and two, incomplete. Terrific coverage on Smith. That time by Ronnie Harris, who is playing today, recovering from an injury.
Surprised a little bit at the play call there, knowing what Iowa's identity is. I'd expect them to run the ball in this situation, but a one-on-one matchup outside with Ronnie Harris. Very physical. There certainly was a lot of contact against Tavon Smith. That's one of those, it's a judgment call for the referee, but nice coverage nonetheless. Ronnie Harris, the guy that missed the last two games with an ankle injury. Big play on third down.
And look who's back to return the punt. Mr. McCaffrey. Fair catch. 26-yard. So Christian McCaffrey ignites the Stanford followers with a 75-yard catch and run. And folks, he brings speed to the dance. It's the McCaffrey family. David Syme, Duke athlete, Olympic silver medalist in the 100 meters. Mom, Lisa, Stanford soccer star in 87-9. Dad, Ed McCaffrey, also won a couple of Super Bowls with John Elway in Denver. Uncle, Billy McCaffrey, and Duke transferred to Vanderbilt. Brother, Max McCaffrey, a wide receiver at Duke. And as you might expect, Mom and Dad are with us here in the stands. And folks, by the way, there are two younger sons. They are outstanding high school football players in Colorado. Some of you recruited young players. And the handoff is to McCaffrey, and he's to the 31-yard line.
That run you just saw right there, Brent, that's what they call their power run. And that's really their bread and butter, where they pull the backside guard. They try and get a bigger body at the point of attack. And they really see those types of plays as body blows. And they're counting on the fact that 2 and 3 yard gains here early in the game on that play will turn into 8, 9, 10+ yard gains later.
Second and five, they just keep it on the ground. Power breaks free again midfield before he is out of bounds. The focal point of the Iowa defense was stop number 5, and clearly, so far, they are completely unable to do that.
And on this play, Brent, you really get to see the patience of Christian McCaffrey. This is where I think he's improved the most as a runner from a year ago, allowing blocks to set themselves up. Putting his foot in the ground, getting north-south. This guy runs between the tackles and outside.
Again, left side breaks another tackle. Out of bounds at the 30. Folks, he wears number 5 because of a legend who played at USC. When he was a youngster, he thought Reggie Bush was the best running back that he watched. Has a poster in his bedroom that he kept when he was growing up all through his high school years. And Christian McCaffrey wearing number 5 is showing you why he broke Barry Sanders' all-purpose yardage record. Another 19-yard gain. First down and 10. And speaking of the legend, Barry Sanders, there is his son. Now, Dad is not here today. He told us he's probably going to be watching for sure back home in the Detroit area. But Barry Sanders, of course, that's the record that Christian McCaffrey broke this year. Barry is going to graduate in the spring, but he could come back for another year at Stanford. Christian replaces him, and he's back. Play action, Hogan. And it'll be third down and 9.
On these types of obvious passing situations, Iowa defensively likes to do something a little bit unique and different. It's what we used to call radar in the National Football League, where they kind of line up and you got defensive linemen and no one puts their hand in the ground, and they try to confuse the offensive line with respect to who's coming. Based on their personnel on the field right now, it doesn't look like they're getting to that package of plays right here, which means that they might suspect Stanford could still try and run the football in this third and long situation.
Kajust and Hooper. Austin Hooper, one of the best tight ends. And they throw to McCaffrey out wide. Another first down. He's down at the 15-yard line.
Yeah, you know, he's just not like Stanford running backs we've seen in the past. Guys like Tyler Gaffney or Stephon Taylor or Toby Gerhardt. He can do so many different things, and that's why they've got to find creative ways to get him the football. So you're going to see them hand it off to him. You're going to see him today in the wildcat behind center, catching the ball to the backfield like we saw in the first snap, and then lining him up at wide receiver and just letting Christian McCaffrey go to work in space.
In the red zone with the wildcat now. He can take the direct snap, as he'll do here, through a pass against USC in the championship game, but he runs it close to the goal line. Desmond King makes the stop for the Hawkeyes, who are under fire here in the first quarter.
Seeing a lot of athleticism up front from Stanford and their offensive line, pulling guards, pulling tackles, and really trying to attack the perimeter of Iowa's defense in the running game. Not so much right up the gut, but getting number 5 outside in space. That's been the game plan early.
Sixth rushing touchdown of the season. So with all eyes focused on number 5, Hogan keeps it and runs to the end zone for Stanford's second touchdown. Does it make any difference to you, Kropina? It's 14-0. The Hawkeyes have been shocked early. They must answer. Well, that famous intersection, Orange Grove and Colorado, where the Grand Parade makes that turn. Much quieter now. Many of the folks, of course, are in the stadium. But if you ever get a chance, it is just a great show to go over to the parade. Here it is, Stanford 14, Iowa nothing. And the Hawkeyes need a lift. Let's see if King can give it to him. Breaks a tackle, battles his way out to the 26-yard line. And 140 total yards already for McCaffrey, receiving and running. As they slip it to Matt Vandenberg on the outside. That's a good first down with Holder defending it for the Cardinals.
And this is already uncharted waters for the Iowa Hawkeyes. They had never trailed by more than 7 points all season long. Already here, with about 9 minutes to go in the first quarter, this is the largest deficit they've faced. Kirk Ferentz going to find out a lot about his team early here. How do they handle this adversity?
So he stepped out of bounds without getting the first down. As I said, on that first down play, it was a good throw in underneath to Henry Krieger Kobel, one of the very active tight ends for this team. George Kittle is the other one.
And I think one of the places Iowa has an advantage offensively in the pass game is at tight end. And you just mentioned it, Brent. Krieger Kobel. They've got another one in George Kittle. Two athletic guys that can line up at different parts of the field. And in situations like this, critical third downs, working the middle of the field against zone coverage could be a space that C.J. Beathard decides to attack.
This is a money down for the Hawkeyes. Third and six, trailing by two touchdowns in the first quarter. Beathard going to try to run for it. He got it. With his feet, keeps the drive alive.
And Brent, we talked about the escapability that C.J. Beathard has and the toughness. Remember, he was just limping after a huge shot he took from Kevin Anderson a few snaps ago. But you have to rush with great gap integrity. You see to the left side of the screen, there's a big hole that Stanford gave up. And as soon as Beathard saw that, he put his foot in the ground and took off.
14 yards on third and six. LaShawn Daniels, whose brother is playing left guard. So both of the Daniels boys are out there. Here comes LaShawn trying to pick his way out to the 39-yard line. Iowa and Stanford territory for the first time here today. The Daniels brothers are such an interesting story. LaShawn, the running back, he's a junior. His brother is a freshman. Both went to Warren, Ohio. Their daddy was a heck of a football player. Did he go to Iowa? No. He played in the Rose Bowl for Ohio State. Complete. And that will make it third and short as they work Vandenberg in the sideline.
Well, the key is what you just mentioned, Brent, staying third and short and having the ability to either run or throw the football and try and keep Stanford off balance. On third downs, those are the downs Stanford's defense likes to bring pressure, and they like to slant and twist their defensive line, and it's been that slanting and twisting that has given Iowa's O-line a lot of issues here all season long. Going in an empty formation, this would look like another pass play.
With the backfield empty on third and three, Beathard picked off, intercepted, headed for the end zone. Touchdown, Stanford, a three-touchdown lead as Quentin Meeks, a freshman, picks it off and dances to the end zone. And right now, it's a mauling by the Stanford Cardinal after the 66-yard pick six.
When you're throwing the ball on a three-step drop, there has to be great timing. The throw was late. And if you're going to miss an outbreaking route, you have to miss it outside to the boundary, not inside. Great job there by the nickel corner, Quentin Meeks, jumping all over that. And the freshman goes pick six.
So last night, it was Alabama's defense doing the job against Michigan State. But here, this afternoon, well, first it was the Stanford offense. But they're saying, we can play a little defense, too. A pick six, and it's 21-zip. So the Hawkeyes, I'm sure, are shocked, trailing 21-0 here as we welcome back to the game presented by Northwestern Mutual. David Sharma's done a fabulous job. Out close to the 30-yard line. C.J. Beathard so far is 5 of 7, but for only 28 yards. They're going to try Wadley as the running back. Now, Wadley was the back who had such a big day against Northwestern. And you're left to wonder if Stanford had started their season in better fashion. They went to Evanston, and they were stunned by the Wildcats. They were dominated in that game. Second down and 9. Back slips up on the 20-yard line. Aziz Shadu was there. He's a good one. The end of the first quarter. All the big plays belong to the Pac-12 champion, Stanford Cardinal. Opened up with a 75-yarder, and they simply took it from there. We welcome you back to the Rose Bowl game presented by Northwestern Mutual. Stanford dominating Iowa the first 15 minutes. The Hawkeyes open the second quarter with a third down and 10.
Got to make sure, Brent, here the offensive line handles the stunting and movements of Stanford's pass rush.
Bethard is tripped up, could not escape Kevin Palma, the linebacker, and Palma would not let loose.
Well, and that's where C.J. Bethard wanted to go with the football, but Stanford that time double covered Matt Vanderberg in the slot. Here he is right here trying to run an in route, but watch once he gets to the middle of the field. You've got Meeks right there covering him, then you've got a linebacker, and then another one in Blake Martinez. C.J. Bethard again forced to hold on to the football, and that allowed for the second sack by Stanford.
Dylan Kidd, Deerfield Beach, Florida, punts it away. And here's McCaffrey from the 38. Dances free. Got a man to beat. Midfield. Two downfield, cuts back, headed for his second touchdown of the game. Light up the magazine covers next August, folks. What a battle for the Heisman Trophy. Here we've got Christian McCaffrey and down LSU way, Leonard Fournette. Light him up, boys.
You simply cannot afford to give Christian McCaffrey a crease, or he will absolutely kill you. With the foot speed he has and the vision and the quickness, this is one of those unique athletes and unique football players you just don't see very often. Hard to imagine he's only a true sophomore.
This is special. I talked to someone who lived in his neighborhood back in Colorado who said he went over and watched all the high school games, and he said Christian ran all over the field, scored touchdowns every week for his high school team. He said, I had no idea how good he was going to be until I watched him here against USC in the Pac-12 championship. This is a 63-yard touchdown. Earlier, if you just joined us, he went 75 yards. He's a magic man, folks. How about those wheels at Christian McCaffrey Sports, eh? Mom up in the stands. There with Pops. King will take a knee and come out at 25.
He whiffed before he took it in. This young true sophomore just commands the football.
Daniels with the handoff for the Hawkeyes. He breaks free. To the 40-yard line, their strongest run of the game. Kind of by.
And this game can't get too much further out of hand for Iowa because they're not built as an offense to throw the football 40 times to win a game. You're down four possessions now. There's still plenty of time. You still need to run the football if you're Iowa, but you can't allow this thing to snowball on you here because that's just not what you're built to do offensively to stay competitive.
Drops it off to his running back Daniels, and he's close to another first down.
Well, Daniels is a guy that I think kind of fits well in this game because of his style of running. He's the biggest back that Iowa has. He's 6 feet tall, 225 pounds. He's extremely physical, and he's downhill. And he's a guy that I think they can lean on a little bit here at this point in the juncture of the game. Running between the tackles, checking the football down to him in the pass game, as you saw right there.
Down. Daniel's giving him a bit of a lift with his legs here. Battles his way across the 45-yard line.
And I like it because Stanford defensively, they're not the same dominant defense that we're used to seeing in years past. You can run on them. And their front seven, especially their D-line, they're a bit undersized. They can get pushed around and moved a little bit. I wouldn't say Stanford's a great tackling defense this year. As a result, they've given up 200 rushing yards in a game three different times this year, give up a bunch of yards to USC in the Pac-12 title game. I think Iowa needs to stick with this formula, keep it on the ground.
Yeah. Second down and long. No daylight for Daniels.
Of course, what Stanford wants to do defensively here is win first and second down and set up those third and long situations. The one good thing Stanford has going for themselves defensively, they have better depth in their front seven. I remember calling a game of theirs mid-season against UCLA. They were rotating three defensive linemen. That's all they had. They've got about six, seven, eight guys they could play in this game, try and keep them fresh. Solomon Thomas, nose tackle right there, one of those guys.
Bethard avoids the rush and drops it off short to Canzari. But it's another third down, and it's going to be a third down and long. The fellow they need to get into this, Jesse, is number 46, George Kittle. They've got to somehow find these tight ends and go to work with it.
Yeah, I mean, those are the quarterback's best friend. You know, more than anything, I think Bethard needs somebody to get open and beat coverage, because for the most part today in this game, black jerseys have been had one white jersey or two white jerseys all over.
Deflected. That was the linebacker who's had a terrific day, Peter Kalambayi.
And it was a great job by Kalambayi, who was on a blitz. Kind of pulled up and saw C.J. Bethard pulling the trigger, and then he was able to jump up in the air and knock this thing down. You're going to see him coming from this side. 34, he's not going to get there, uses his eyes, stops the rush, just plays the football. Very nice athletic play by Peter Kalambayi, forcing the punt.
Well, we're going to get to see him again. Number five, back deep here for the Cardinal. He'll fair catch it. So showing good judgment also. Fair catch at the 14-yard line. McCaffrey and Stanford leading the Hawkeyes by four touchdowns. Happy New Year, everybody. It has certainly been a happy New Year for the McCaffrey family so far. Christian McCaffrey leading Stanford to a 28-0 lead. He's back in. He's the eye back. And Christian will come again as we check in down below with Maria. Maria, what a job so far by Christian.
Yeah, and we're seeing just how special he is, Britt, but his senior quarterback, Kevin Hogan, says as soon as he stepped foot on campus, he knew that this was going to be a great guy. After practice, he said he walked right up to the coaches' offices, and for the first time, he said, there's an underclassman that we have to play. We have no choice. And ever since that, he's been a part of the Stanford program. He said that he's done things that he's never seen a player do ever in practice and in games.
On second down, Hogan with the completion to Kajust. You know, Maria, he was quite frustrated. I'm talking about Christian McCaffrey now. As a freshman, he really wanted to play more. Remember, he'd been all everything in high school back in Colorado. And he told the coaches, but the coach said, get in that weight room, work a little bit harder. And so he did. He's much stronger than when
Well, yeah, just take a look at him. I mean, this guy is absolutely rocked up. When you watch him in pregame running around, I mean, he's mesomorphic. Does not look like a 19-year-old true sophomore.
And the yardage total continues to climb. Here comes McCaffrey. Could be number three. Hold on, everybody. There's a penalty flag on this one. Oh, this is something. Players appear to be headed back. This one's not going to count.
Holding offense number 89. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul, first and 10.
And Brad, it was Devin Kajust, the wide receiver, who was way down the field blocking on the cornerback, Desmond King. And on the play, Desmond King kind of got himself turned around, discombobulated, lost track of where McCaffrey was. But watch 89 right here. He just barely grabs the left shoulder pad, and that's all it took to hold up King. That's a great call. That is holding. And that, of course, negates the long touchdown by McCaffrey.
Yeah, no question about it. That freed him at that particular
point. The fact that he turned him and pulled and twisted him back, I think, is why that call was made.
Barry Sanders is the running back. He's out now with a little screen, and they overthrew him.
could have been a good grant, good game.
You know, the amazing, you know, we're talking about Christian McCaffrey, and you kind of, you ask yourself, well, why don't you just give this guy the football every play? The fact is, Stanford has four excellent running backs as McCaffrey now comes back on the field, but Raymond Wright will get in the game in short yardage goal line situations. Barry Sanders, we've talked about Bryce Love. They've got a lot of different guys that when they have the ball in their hands are very, very dangerous, and then they can therefore spell Christian McCaffrey.
As they have right now with Wright, as you just saw there, Jesse, where you were talking about that depth of running back, and here comes Wright. Terrific short yardage runner, powerful runner. Picked up, it looked like, about 9 yards.
The amazing
thing, come to third down.
Yeah, the amazing thing to me, you know, about Stanford is just how multiple they are in the run game. Two back sets, one back sets, between the tackles, outside, quarterback runs, zone read, wildcat, jet sweeps, multiple offensive linemen like you're seeing right now. They can play with 7 or 8 different old linemen in these short yardage situations.
Here
to
comes
bring
the
in
jumbo
the beef.
Look.
There it is. How do you prepare for all this, even if you have a month if you're on?
Fanaka, Brandon Fanaka wears number 94. He's down there. Here comes Jumbo. And by golly, that was good Hawkeye defense that time. Wright tried to get airborne on it and did not pick up the first down.
Now, Stanford is the best fourth down offense in the entire country. They've converted 12 of 14 fourth downs on the season, and I would expect no doubt Stanford to go for this here. A lot of weight on the left side down here of this formation for Stanford.
So here's your fourth. Stepped over to the left side. I think that Hogan may have seen that that was the place to go when he changed things up. When you talk to the coaches about Kevin Hogan, it's interesting that he talks to the backs and the linemen about the blocking that he wants in a given game. That's how bright Kevin Hogan is. The coaches actually stand in the back and watch him.
Well, on that side, they had two extra offensive linemen. They had Nick Davidson at 285 pounds and David Bright at 294 pounds. That's the way Kevin Hogan wanted to go. They got a great lead block by their fullback, Chris Harrell, who, by the way, weighs 244 pounds himself. But nice job at the line of scrimmage by Hogan getting him in the right play.
Now Magic is back. The fake. That's a play. He faked a fumble. Gonna go deep. Got a man. Touchdown. A play they practiced all week. Michael Rector on a fake fumble. You freeze the safeties. And Hogan came up firing. How about that?
And that's a play I've never seen actually run in a game, but executed beautifully.
It was executed in practice perfectly.
Yeah, I mean, and it's Kevin Hogan with his ball skills being Houdini in the backfield, forcing Iowa's defense to freeze just for a second. That allowed Michael Rector to get deep.
I want to tell you one thing about that play. Ukropina adds the extra point. Jesse, in practice, you couldn't hear with the crowd here, but in practice, the players on Stanford yell, now as he puts it down, they yell, fumble, fumble. And that freezes the defense just enough, and he comes up firing. First time they've been held scoreless in the first half of this season. They'll go into that locker room, and someone should spell pride on the blackboard, P-R-I-D-E. And for Stanford, someone should spell finish. Let's go to Maria with Coach Shaw.
Well, Coach, you hold Iowa out of the end zone, and you're up by 5 scores. What's the statement your team made in the first half?
You know, I tell our guys all the time, you know, we don't try to make statements. We just want to play football. You know, we got one more game with these seniors now, just down to a half. We just want to play our best football and take whatever the score comes. And the score is in our favor right now, but we talk about on the sidelines the whole game. Scoreboard doesn't matter. Only thing that matters is how we play.
We saw Christian McCaffrey score on 2 explosive plays. What has he given to you in the first half?
It's just what he is. I mean, he's having the best season any skill position player has ever had in the history of the game. And the stats and the numbers prove it. And this is another game. And God bless him. I know exactly how he's going to be in the sidelines. He's going to be angry in the sidelines that he didn't get another touchdown. So we're going to come out fired up, ready to go.
All right. Thanks for your time, Coach.
Thank you.
Thanks, Maria. Indeed, he had another touchdown. And then there was a holding penalty, a very legitimate call, that brought that one back. But what a show from number 5. and the Stanford Cardinal. They have punched Iowa in the mouth. Will the Hawkeye stand up and battle back in the second half? We'll find out. Welcome back to the Rose Bowl, presented by Northwestern Mutual. Christian may be headed for another record as number 5 spills out onto the floor. A 35-0 lead for the Stanford Cardinal. Just, I was talking to fellows around the media during halftime, and everybody said the same thing. We didn't see this coming.
No, Stanford, that's about as good as I've seen a football team look in all three facets of the game in 30 minutes of football as I've seen in a very, very long time. Nothing went wrong. Offensively, Christian McCaffrey running, catching the football. They completed a bomb down the field to Michael Rector on a trick play where Kevin Hogan fumbled it on the ground, picked it up, designed. The defense is stopping the run. They're getting pressure on C.J. Beathard. They've been great in coverage. They've got a punt return score from number 5, with the exception of a holding penalty that called back a long touchdown by McCaffrey. Stanford has been lights out. David Shaw must love what he's seen. And Kirk Ferentz in Iowa, they've got to find a way to pick up their pace and pick up their execution in all three facets.
Here comes King for the 25 as we go down below to Maria Taylor.
I spoke with Kirk Ferentz, and he said the main focus for his team now is getting back to playing Hawkeye football and what is more characteristic of this team. I heard a couple of players coming out and saying, let's play Iowa football again. Coach says there's some small battles that they need to start winning up front, but unfortunately the team just didn't play well at all in the first half. They're trying to forget that right now and rally back in the second, guys.
Yeah, exactly. He has one half, 30 minutes to right the ship. Daniels. First down, quick slant, and dropped again. They start with another mistake. Vandenberg just didn't hang on.
And that's just not Iowa football, exactly what Maria just said. I mean, what is Iowa football? It's running the football on offense. It's establishing the line of scrimmage, not committing penalties, not turning the football over, stopping the run on defense, taking the football away. And that ball may have gotten somewhat deflected by Kevin Anderson. Still, it's right in the breadbasket of their best wide receiver. The execution level for Kirk Ferentz just hasn't been there from his team.
Beathard trying to find an open receiver. That's to throw to the safety valve, Krieger Coble.
You know, and the scramble rules for Iowa's wide receivers are going to have to get way, way better here in the second half as well. C.J. Beathard is running for his life behind this offensive line that's having issues protecting against Stanford's pass rush. So these wide receivers need to know now, from here on out, I'm going to run my route. If I don't get the ball right away, find open green grass. Find a place that I can give number 16 a place to throw the ball.
Now, Stanford's defense keeps changing the point of attack. They keep moving to different positions. They set up differently on a late signal from the, look at that. They get a man wide open for the sack. And that was Aziz Shidu again. And what a fine-looking football player he is. But late defensive signals are coming as they recognize certain tendencies in the Hawkeye formation.
But it's just a bad job blocking up front. You got James Daniels at left guard, who's a true freshman, who just basically allows Shidu to run right by him. Again, poor execution, whether it's dropping passes, not being good blocking, just not the brand of football we're used to seeing from the Iowa Hawkeyes.
Christian McCaffrey is back to return the punt. He lets it bounce, and it's going to be down right about the 35-yard line. Play action to him, fire the slant, and that's complete. And that was Austin Hooper. Now, there's a name we haven't mentioned much, but folks, those of you who are fans of the NFL, you keep an eye on number 18. We don't know if he's going to leave early or come back for Stanford, but like a lot of those fellows, Zach Ertz and some of the others who play Sunday football, Austin Hooper will make an NFL roster. He's 6'4", 248, went to that great high school, De La Salle, up in Northern California, and they come back with the star. Here's the magic man, dancing free. He's got King, who wrestles and throws him down with emphasis. The Thorpe Award winner said, not on my watch this time.
You know, it starts up front with this phenomenal Stanford offensive line. And these zone schemes, you got to get movement. It's a zone scheme to the left, getting penetration, getting blocks. And then you got to be patient as a running back in that kind of scheme as well, looking for the cutback lane. That's exactly what McCaffrey finds right here. And again, we talked about it, tough to tackle. Greg Mabin, 13, has a shot. This is normally a very good tackling secondary. Christian McCaffrey's making him look silly.
First down, throwing to the end zone, and incomplete. What a great block that time by right tackle Casey Tucker. Desmond King trying to do it on both sides of the field. I got to tell you something. Big Casey Tucker, 6'6", 300 from Gilbert, Arizona. He lowered the boom on his rush, man.
Yeah, and this was almost an interception, Brent. They might want to take a look at this again. Desmond King does a great job kind of diving out and getting the football. And he was, oh, see, it comes out late at the very last second. But it looked like here he had possession, and it just came out late. I'll tell you, you've got to be careful when you're throwing to the side of the field that number 14 lines up on. His eye-hand coordination and his ball skills are crazy good.
Here is Wright. Powerful running back across the 15-yard line. So McCaffrey on that last run picked up 30 more yards. He's in pursuit of the Aberderis total yardage record here at a Rose Bowl game. You've got to say that if he stays in the game and they keep giving it to him, he's favored. And keep in mind, with bowl games now, his totals will add on to his regular season total yardage record. So he's going to start to pull away from the other fellas. Deflected. Big defensive play. That was Hess, Parker Hess.
Yeah, Parker Hesse coming off the edge. He's a freshman. He had to replace an outstanding player in Drew Ott, who got hurt earlier in the year with an ACL injury against Illinois. There's a freshman with a pick six against Nebraska late in the game on a play very similar to that.
Conrad Ukropina. Hogan upset with himself on that play. It's a 31-yard field goal attempt for the young man who grew up right here in Pasadena. His family with about 100 tickets, he told me, down on the field before the game. From the right hash, nails it.
Good.
So Ukropina was a real good quarterback. He had suffered a horrendous arm injury. And so with the team, all he could do was kick the football around. He had never kicked before. And here he is. He's the specialist for the Stanford Cardinal in dramatic fashion. He beat Notre Dame this year. That was his family over there. Like I said, 100 tickets for the young man from Pasadena, California. Just as we were leading, Ukropina, who had kicked that field goal successfully, was changing jerseys, putting on 94. Why was he doing that?
Well, because he normally wears number 34, but they have a linebacker, Peter Kalambayi, that's on the kickoff team. And by rule, you can't have two guys on the field at the same time wearing the same jersey number. It's the only time all year long that we've seen it's a kicker changing his jersey number.
I think I said 94. That's Fanaka's other number. They got three or four guys who changed these jerseys. Clearly, number 92. So here we go. Here comes King again. He's been a busy return man. Out to the 26-yard line. So now it is first down and 10. Daniels is the Hawkeye running back. Off play action. Can't find an open receiver. Sacked at the 35 by Solomon Thomas. Defensive tackle out of Coppell, Texas.
And again, it's just bad blocking inside. I think it was number 79, Sean Welsh, is engaged with him early and just completely lets him go. Watch number 90 is going to be kind of coming in here right over the right guard. Just no one stays with him. And C.J. Beathard has no chance. The different pictures that Stanford in this 3-4 look has given this offensive line, they've been completely lost.
And second and 18. Goes to the middle to his tight end, Krieger. Hopefully gets some of it back.
This is one of the few times we've seen C.J. Beathard have an opportunity to throw the ball on time. without anybody from Stanford around him. And this is now desperation time. You can forget a lot about the running game if you're the Iowa Hawkeyes. It's not what you're built to do, but you're now going to have to rely on C.J. Beathard and wide receivers and tight ends. Someone's just going to have to make a play. In tight coverage, someone's going to have to fight for the football and make something positive happen.
Show blitz coming up the middle. Beathard. And that'll bring up a fourth down. Hillier was the target on that play.
But another bad play because the quarterback drops the shotgun snap and the timing gets affected. His execution, as Kirk Ferentz looks on, just hasn't been right in any aspect, in any facet. Now the main question is, I don't care who you have outside in a fourth and long situation, can you give C.J. Beathard time? Look at Stanford again, crowding the line of scrimmage. They've got six guys up on the line, and Iowa doesn't know which one of these dudes is coming. Some are going to drop out. They might all come.
So on fourth down, Beathard has to backpedal, fires, first down. So Kanziri makes the grab, and the Hawkeyes in the red zone.
These two had a phenomenal effort together on a huge fourth down earlier in the half. C.J. Beathard spins out, buying time with linebacker Kevin Palma bearing down on him. What about Jordan Kanziri? He's not playing 100% with the right ankle injury. Finds his way out of the backfield. Tough catch for another huge fourth down conversion. Second time those two guys have hooked up on fourth.
Daniels back in as the running back. Left side. But only for a yard before the Cardinal ganged up on him.
You know, a guy that you mentioned earlier, Brent, and a guy whose name we haven't called a lot is tight end number 46, George Kittle, who's a guy that they like to throw to down in this area of the field, 46. He's actually coming off the field right now. It's like he was kind of favoring that left arm a little bit. He may have gotten banged up, left shoulder on that last play. He's been a huge weapon for them in the red zone all year with six touchdown catches. He's a really good blocker, but this is kind of the area of the field they like to throw to him in. You see, he's really smart on the sideline. Someone else now has got to step up.
Beathard got protection that time, and it through the hands of Krieger Coburn.
Yeah, the ball got deflected by Peter Kalambayi at the line of scrimmage, who, again, that was the second time he's gotten his hands on a football thrown by C.J. Beathard. There's just so much versatility that Stanford gets from their linebackers. Peter Kalambayi, Kevin Anderson, just watch 34, doing another great job. It just kind of glanced off his shoulder pad. I think that's why it ended up being thrown behind Krieger Coburn. You talk about the versatility of these linebackers. They can put their hand in the ground, stop the run. They can rush the passer, and they're making plays. Kalambayi having a big day.
Third down and 15 for the Hawkeyes. Beathard won't get free. Protection broke down. No one was free. Brennan Scarlett among the defenders in there for Stanford.
And it was Mike Tyler, number 33, that completely collapsed the left side of the pocket. He walked Cole Crosston, a left tackle, right back into C.J. Beathard. A lot coming off this side right here. Speed to power, a nice transition. That collapsed the pocket, and then it was just a feast in the backfield for Stanford.
Well, Marshall Kane, one of the earlier heroes for Iowa, is on to attempt a field goal to put them on the board. Looks good. 39-yarder. Iowa will not be shut out. But 3:36 remaining in the third quarter, and Stanford enjoying a 35-point lead. 3.5 minutes remaining here in quarter number three. After the Iowa field goal, Stanford will get the ball back. And here comes McCaffrey. Out to the 28-yard line, approaching that record.
You know, you think back to this year at the start of the season, there weren't a lot of people talking about this guy with respect to Heisman hype. That changed very quickly. No doubt next year he'll be an early season frontrunner.
Here he comes. Breaks that first tackle again, approaches the first down marker. He may have it with that spot. What's fascinating is that the bench is well aware, and they do have the first down. The bench is well aware that he is approaching the total yardage record here at a Rose Bowl game. Aberderis, Wisconsin receiver and return man, has it. And there you are as he closes in right now. And he is almost a certainty to get that record. The only thing that would have prevented him is if they take him out of the game and rest him. But the bench, we are told, is aware. Over 18 yards a touch. The freshman around, and he gets thrown back by Nelson.
Well, you think about next year. There's some GMs in the National Football League, and there's some head coaches that are going to have a very interesting decision, especially on the teams that have to pick early in the draft. Between that guy right there, Christian McCaffrey, who will be eligible to go to the NFL.
You mean a year from next April.
That's what, that's Leonard Fournette. Leonard Fournette, Deshaun Watson at Clemson, Miles Garrett at Texas A&M. You're right. After the 2016 college football season, there are some really, really intriguing prospects at the top of that draft, and I think number five is going to be one of those guys.
Here comes Hogan, firing. And that should have been intercepted, I think. Wasn't it Jesse Bauer? Didn't he have a good shot at that?
Yeah, I think he did. It was hard to tell whether or not Jaleel Johnson, a defensive tackle, got his hand on this and deflected it. But the ball was way off the mark. I think he was trying to find Michael Rector underneath. You see, there's Johnson right there, 67. Just watch him. Does he get a hand on it? It's hard to tell if he actually deflected. The nose of the ball kind of tips down. I don't think Bo Bauer was expecting that. That would have been a tough catch regardless. There's so many good players on this Iowa defense. Guys like Desmond King and Jaleel Johnson we haven't talked a lot about in this game.
Third down and 22. Stanford forced a punt. As we come to the end of the third quarter. Ordinarily, I would say, stay tuned. The money quarter is coming up. Not today, folks. Stay tuned and see if Christian McCaffrey can set the Rose Bowl record for total yards in a single game. He's fielded at the 30 by King. King with daylight. Breaks. Oh, he's tripped up at the 35-yard line. That would have been a touchdown, but Martinez, right there, number four, tripped him up.
Well, Christian McCaffrey's not the only versatile athlete playing in this game. Desmond King, one of the best cover corners in college football. We mentioned it, the Jim Thorpe Award winner. Also very dangerous in the return game, and you don't have to give him a lot of space to make a play. Talk about making a dude miss, getting north-south, puts his foot in the ground, and thankfully, the guy that leads the Pac-12 conference in tackles per game is there for Stanford to make that stop. Otherwise, that's six.
C.J. Beathard hands it off to his running back, Waterman. I have to tell you, C.J. Beathard has an uncle by the name of Pete as we come into the fourth quarter. Pete Beathard, quarterback, USC, in one of the most dramatic Rose Bowl games that I ever watched. On television, NBC was broadcasting it in color. It was early on, early 60s. Ron Vanderkeller of Wisconsin, and that was CJ's uncle Pete. He was the winner that day, but Vander Cullen and the Badgers gave him all they could ask for in that game. Second down and nine. Beathard's in trouble. Down he goes. So in 1963, this was the game that I referred to. This is Pete Beathard. He was the co-MVP. Tossing for the touchdown pass. Rolling to the left under Badger pressure. And firing for another one.
That's
but
amazing.
Ron Vanderkellen kept firing away at him. And I mean, USC was forced all the way to the final 2 minutes. It was interesting. CJ has never looked at a tape of that game. And I said, CJ, you got to go get a tape of it. You'll be amazed at what Pete did. Firing downfield.
The first and only explosive play in the passing game for Iowa tonight comes in the fourth quarter. C.J. Beathard pre-snap found the matchup he wanted. His leading receiver, Matt Vandenberg, in the slot, working against safety Cody Whitfield. Great route excellent throw. And Kirk Ferentz's Iowa Hawkeyes, true to form, they continue to battle. They just don't quit.
Oh, he hit the upright and it ricocheted to the right. No good. Kane misses the extra point. Matt Vandenberg, he's a young man from Brandon, South Dakota. And watch as he comes down the sideline with that burst. And it's the first touchdown of the game for the Hawkeyes. Christian McCaffrey closing in on a couple of Rose Bowl game records. If he gets a chance to return this kick, he'll take down the all-purpose yards. Needs 11 now to tie, 12 to win it. So here he is waiting to see if he's going to get a chance on his kickoff. On the ground, they want to keep it away from him. And it will be the up back right. Now the other record that McCaffrey is closing in on, and he is just 2 receiving yards away from being the first man in Rose Bowl history to rush for better than 100 yards. He has 146 and also 100 yards receiving, and he sits at 98 right now. The Stanford sideline, we are told, well aware of the situation regarding Christian. So he goes out as a receiver. Hogan, though, looks and fires the other way. Ball is out to the 36-yard line with Austin Hooper, his third catch of the game, the big fella.
You know, this offense is just so explosive all year long, finding big plays. And it's not just Christian McCaffrey. We mentioned earlier the other 3 running backs that can hit the home run. They've got guys like Hooper, a tight end. They've got other receivers that can run by you. The last 13 games in a row now, Stanford scored over 30 points. It's the longest streak in the FBS. More speed at the skill positions than David Shaw's ever had at Stanford.
Here's McCaffrey. That's the total yardage record right there. One record down. Total yardage record for the Rose Bowl just fell on that run.
So the runner-up for the Heisman Trophy had the Jim Thorpe Award winner Desmond King on an island one-on-one. Desmond King wanted no part of it. Didn't even break down, completely whiffed. I am so impressed, because it appears to me like Christian McCaffrey's broken the will of a lot of players on Iowa's defense. That's something that number 5 can do every week. He's been doing it a lot this year. There's some pretty standout players in this Iowa D that haven't been able to even touch number 5.
They certainly took care of that. Hogan keeping it is down.
I keep wondering if they're trying to get number 5, Christian McCaffrey, a catch. See if he can break that record.
Well, they tried, but they made it a lateral.
I know. Well, and I'm wondering, now McCaffrey's coming off again. But, you know, these last couple plays, they've kind of gotten him out in routes. And that last play, Kevin Hogan didn't see anything downfield, so he just took off and ran it.
Should just give him a little screen on the outside, you know?
There's a lot of ways to get. You can just throw him a now pass. Just line him up outside. Just throw him one of those smoke passes we see all the time. It's going to make somebody miss.
Quarterback Keith. And he's to the 9-yard line. His last game as a Stanford quarterback. Johnson with the stop for the Hawkeyes.
You know, and I think there's something to be said for quarterbacks that have experience. But think of all the big game experience Kevin Hogan has. 3 Pac-12 title games. This is his 3rd Rose Bowl. He's been through all the different wars against USC and Oregon and Notre Dame. I think that's something that really bodes well for him at the next level. A team somewhere in the NFL knows this guy's been on the big stage. In games like this, the lights never get too bright. Stage is never too big. He can handle the pressure.
McCaffrey was a blocker up in the air. Intercepted. Deflected pass. Intercepted by the Hawkeyes. They had a foot down in the end zone. And that was Josie Jewell, who is known as the Outlaw. But Why not if you're Josie, you're the Outlaw.
Miles Taylor at safety number 19 is the one that really makes this play, though. He's matched up against a much bigger Hooper at tight end. Desmond King comes in late, knocks it up in the air before Josie Jewell can clean it up. And this is something they did. 18 picks on the year, led the Big Ten. Just came too late in this one tonight.
So we've got a timeout. Hawkeye football when you come back. Well, I mentioned a short time ago that I wanted to tell a story about Jake Rudock and head coach Kirk Ferentz. Rudock, of course, leading Michigan to that win over Florida. It is unusual for a youngster to transfer within the conference, but Coach Ferentz said, we're not stopping him. He can go wherever he wants. He was such a good performer, loyal when he was here. And the handoff by Beathard goes to Wadley. And I must say, I know things aren't going well for Coach Ferentz today, but he has always demonstrated class to me.
Yeah, no, he sure has. And I just love the way he does things. And it's very blue collar. There's no magic formula. The things he preaches to win games, they stand true, stand the test of time.
Beathard trying to hold him off, and there's a penalty flag as he goes down. It has been a very, very tough afternoon for Beathard. He has felt the brunt of this Stanford defense all game long.
He's been sacked seven times, Brent. Seven times. And there's been a lot of others, like plays like that, where he just barely was able to get out early. I was thinking on that play live, maybe that might have been a face mask call. I wasn't sure if the defensive lineman had got a hand in under his helmet, or you see he's rolling his
first
neck around.
Foul, grasping the helmet opening, defense number 50. That's a 15-yard penalty. Automatic first down.
One of their backup linebackers, some of the backups now, Jesse, are starting to get time here for the Cardinal.
Yeah, I don't know if they were expecting to get this much time, especially here in the fourth quarter, but you know, I want to go back to Iowa, and I really think Iowa Hawkeye fans have potentially another special season coming again next year. And you look at the way the schedule sets up. They're going to get Iowa State, or this is what happened, sorry, this year, and it was remarkable. You know, going 12-0 in the regular season, but of course people, you know, doubted them because they didn't play Ohio State, they didn't play Michigan State, Michigan or Penn State, but I think still proved a lot in that Big Ten title game.
All right, after this tackle, Jesse, here's next year's for you.
Yeah, you know, it's going to set up, I think, pretty well for the Iowa Hawkeyes. And Iowa State, North Dakota State, you got to watch out for them of the FCS. They're coming into town early in the year. They do have two crossover opponents this year against Penn State and Michigan, but very, very key. They get Northwestern, Wisconsin, and Nebraska at home. And when you consider C.J. Beathard's back, they're going to have three good running backs back, three good linemen, their leading receiver. They may only lose three or four starters on defense. I think Iowa can repeat as Big Ten West champs next season.
Mitchell flares out. They hit number 32. First down, Hawkeyes. Reed with the stop, another one of the Stanford backups.
A big key for Iowa, obviously, next year, too, is going to be just keeping C.J. Beathard healthy, something he hasn't been all season. Since that hip injury against Pitt really early, this guy's shown tremendous toughness.
Dropping it off to the running back again. Here's Mitchell. This will be third down and short with the clock running down.
Talking earlier, Brent, about Kirk Ferentz and the job he did for Iowa. What about David Shaw and Stanford guiding this team through just a tumultuous schedule? And it really looks to me like Stanford is physically and emotionally recharged in this game. They had 13 games, no true bye week.
Far side wide open is Wadley. Touchdown, Iowa. Guess who's winning the second half? The Hawkeyes. That's a 31-yard touchdown play, Jess.
They keep battling, and there was a total coverage bust on the short side of the field for Stanford. I don't know if it was their corner, Aleem Murphy, number 23, but there were multiple Stanford defenders running with a wide receiver, and nobody stayed out wide to cover the back out of the backfield.
Hawkeyes with 15, make it 16 second half points to 3 for Stanford. The problem, of course, for Iowa is that the Cardinal put up 35 in the first half. One of the great venues in all of American sport, and really it's been my pleasure to join those legendary voices. There's the onside kick. Cardinals recover it at midfield. Had the good hands team out there, Holder and Stallworth. Stallworth making the play.
Brent, you told me this is your 15th Rose Bowl.
You know, I've lost track. The first one I did with Dick Vermeil.
Right.
Okay. We did a Michigan-Washington game. It turned out it was Don James' final game. Great shootout. Tyrone Wheatley was the star for the Wolverines. He was named into the Rose Bowl Hall of Fame last year. Dick Vermeil. He's the only man. Vermeil's the only man to have coached a Rose Bowl game and also broadcast.
So you've done 15. This is Stanford's 15th Rose Bowl. They played in the first one in 1902.
I wasn't there. Now. Come on. Come on. I knew you were setting me up for that. Now. And there's McCaffrey. And there's the other record for our young man, Christian McCaffrey. We knew he was going to get it
somehow, some way. And, you know, he's still going to stay in the game. But tell you what a performance Christian McCaffrey's had from the very, very first play. Christian McCaffrey has left an impact in this game. It's a fitting way for a remarkable season to end in the Rose Bowl, setting multiple records with his family here watching and all David Shaw and Stanford faithful as well. Wow.
And great work by the Sports Information Office to tell the sideline that the young man was just a couple of receiving yards away as Hogan goes deep for the end zone. Touchdown, Stanford. Michael Rector. The deep threat strikes again. That's a 42-yard touchdown for Hogan. Oh, they get him early. Oh, he did not see that coming. That's, David Shaw. With the Gatorade, they ganged up on him on that one.
Yeah, they sure did. You hear some boos from the Iowa fans, obviously, of 38-16, taking a shot deep on a double move. But there's Rector. He beats Jordan Lomax, the safety outside. I don't know if he got in, Brent. I mean, the football to me looked like it might have been out of bounds. It's where the football is in relationship to the plane.
I thought the football was,
it's in his left hand, his right foot's in it. He's kind of cradling it with the left. It's hard to tell if he went over the pylon or not. Now, he touched the pylon, which extends the goal line in that case, which is why it's a touchdown. That was close.
Let me tell you, for anybody who gets upset when somebody scores a touchdown, play football.
Hey, I agree.
I am so beyond that.
I played for Steve Spurrier.
That's right.
If you don't want us to score,
stop us. The extra point. Yes. 61 points now on the board in this Rose Bowl. Stins high in 2 minutes, and here comes King. You know, the one thing, great stop on that. Just, I think, a little short of the 15-yard line.
But what a day this has been for that family right there. Christian McCaffrey's father, Ed, his mom, brothers.
Wadley out to the 32. Well, they did not quit the second half.
No, they didn't.
They played hard.
And I think that's a testament to Kirk Ferentz and this coaching staff and the leaders on Iowa's team.
Complete to Smith. Backup defenders on for Coach Shaw right now. They're shaking hands on that Stanford sideline. They've won another Rose Bowl.
They're gonna be doubted again next year, Brent. Off-season, people are gonna say, well, you lost Kevin Hogan, you lost some offensive linemen, you lost 6 starters on defense, you got a brutal schedule next year.
There's one person not gonna be doubted. Number
Christian McCaffrey. That's right. I gotta tell you, just like Stanford does every year, just don't talk a lot. They're gonna go back, they're gonna work hard, they're gonna have a quarterback competition between Ryan Burns and Keller Crist. They're going to reload on the offensive line like they always do, and they're just going to do their deal. And you know, it won't surprise me at all next year. This is a team, once again, behind that guy right there, number 5, Christian McCaffrey, that's competing for yet again another Pac-12 championship.
is the McCaffrey family. Right after us, it's Oklahoma and Ole Miss. And of course, the Iowa quarterback, C.J. Beathard, had verbally committed to Ole Miss coming out of high school. And then when there was a coaching change down there, he backed away. And that's when Iowa was able to recruit him. There were some connections with the Beathard family. And so C.J. came to Iowa City. 16 seconds remaining. Fumble. Stanford pounces on it. A period on a tremendous overall performance. Stanford wins the Rose Bowl. Christian McCaffrey breaks two records. Greatest formation in football. Kirk Ferentz will go across the field now. Seek out David Shaw. And number five is with Maria Taylor. Let's go to Maria.
Well, Christian, quite an explosive night. You break two Rose Bowl records. How aware were you of your production all throughout the game?
Not at all, really. You know, when you're playing, the game goes by so fast, and you really just focus on the next play. And so I think that's why our team is successful, is because, you know, we don't worry about what's happening in the now. We worry about the next play and what we can do to help the team be successful.
Well, it seems as though you guys came out very fast. You had two long runs and touchdowns. What was the focus of this team coming into the Rose Bowl game?
Just be us. You know, there's a lot of talk on, you know, a lot of other teams and all that stuff, but we just knew that we can be extremely good when we focus on what we're doing and executing our offensive plays. And so for us, it was just come in and execute.
You found yourself in New York. You were the runner-up for the Heisman Trophy. What kind of motivation did you have coming into this matchup after having such a great journey to New York?
The motivation always stays there. You know, I mean, all the great players always play with a chip on our shoulder, and you know, that's why you see successful teams do what they do, is because they don't worry about any individual accolades, because, you know, we know that all those are a part of a team, and that's a team win.
And how would you describe the journey of this season? You open up the year with a loss to Northwestern, but make your way back to the Rose Bowl game. What have you guys been talking about in the locker room to make it to this moment?
You know, we just never gave up. You know, when everybody else had their chips against us, you know, we bought into each other, and we bought into, you know, what Stanford football means. And that's never giving up, and that's being extremely, you know.
Better than Barry.
You know, very detailed on offense and not giving up. But, you know, we had a choice. We could have folded after that first game or come together. And you know, I couldn't ask for better teammates and better people to enjoy this win with, because, you know, it was us against the wall when we were playing.
All right, you hear people saying Heisman behind me. Will that be on your mind at all when you take the field in our season?
No, you know, you can't focus on all that stuff at all. You got to really just focus on you and becoming the best player you could be.
Right, thanks for your time.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
What a grounded young man he is, Jesse. And in that interview, you know, he's been around his father, Ed, through the years. He's seen how professional athletes handle themselves. Longest of his career was the first play from scrimmage for Stanford here today. So that wraps us up here in Pasadena. But remember, we're going to send you to the All-State Sugar Bowl. Oklahoma State and Ole Miss. And a reminder that a week from Monday, of course, it'll be the national championship. Clemson and Alabama. Now, let's throw it to Bob Wischeson and Brock Heward at the Sugar Bowl.